Hello and welcome in this video lecture series. Today we are going to continue our discussion on application layer protocols. Let's resume our discussion from SMTP and POP. So SMTP is basically stands for Simple Mail Transfer Protocol. From this word mail, you can understand that emails are transferred using SMTP. So mail is kind of message. So SMTP is used to transfer a message from one system to another system. Now you may ask that if we have already a protocol called FTP, then why we are using another protocol called SMTP in order to transfer a file from one system to another system? Reason is that in case of FTP, if you transfer the file from sender to receiver, both the hosts should be online at the same time. While in case of SMTP, sender can send its message at any time as per their convenience, and receiver will retrieve the same message as per their convenience. It is not necessary to present both the sender and receiver online at the same time. So to understand how this SMTP protocol works, let's understand some important component used in this protocol. First is called user agent. User agent is basically a first component of email. It is a program to compose, reads, replies to and forward messages. Means in order to compose, read or reply, this user agent will be used. Means user agent will be present in the sender side and receiver side. Sender side, this user agent will compose the mail and forward the message. While at the receiver side, it will read and replies. Other component is called mailbox. Mailbox is basically part of local hard drive, a special file with permission restrictions. Only owner of the mailbox has access to it. So suppose this sender A and receiver B, they both are connected with the same mail server. Then there will be a space in the hard drive that will be dedicated for this sender and this receiver. So this is called mailbox, and these mailbox are restricted in such a way that only owner can access it. Suppose this is the mailbox for A and this is the mailbox for B. So what are the messages and mails are available here? Only B can access it. And what are the messages available in this mailbox? These mail will be accessible by A only. So in order to send the email from A to B, it is necessary that this user agent will compose the email and forward the same to the mailbox of this receiver B. And from this mailbox, we will retrieve the same by using its user agent. So now this user agent will fetch this email. So this is how, when both the systems are connected with the same email server. So it is basically a very simple scenario. Let's see another one. When this sender A and receiver B are connected with the separate email server. So this is a mail server at sender side, and this is the mail server at receiver side. So in order to forward the mail from sender A to receiver B, it is necessary that user agent of this host A will compose the mail and forward the same to the mail server available at receiver side B. So in this mail server, suppose this is the mailbox for this receiver. And from this mailbox, this receiver B retrieve the emails by using its user agent. So in this case also, sender and receiver side user agent will be required. In order to send the email from one mail server to another mail server, here we need to forward the same over the internet. So these two mail server will be connected through internet. So in order to forward the mail via this internet from one mail server to another mail server, mail transfer agent will be required. mail transfer agent. In short, it is called MTA. This mail transfer agent is basically a client and server application. So in this mail server also there will be a MTA, and here it is going to act as a server. So MTA is basically a client server application where the message will be pushed from client to server. So now this user agent at sender side is going to compose and forward the message to this mail transfer agent. Now this mail transfer agent is going to forward the same to this mail transfer agent server, MTA server. And from this MTA, email will be stored here in the mailbox of B. And whenever this user V will be convenient to read its email, it will fetch the same by using its user agent. So this is how this process works when sender and receivers are connected on a different email server. Let's see one more scenario here. Suppose sender A and receiver B are connected through a different mail server. So this is the mail server for A and this is the mail server for B. And these mail servers are connected through internet. But in this case, this sender A is not directly connected with this mail server. It is connected with this email server by some LAN or WAN network. So in order to forward the email from sender A to receiver B, it would be required to have a user agent at sender side and one user agent at receiver side. Also, it is required to have MTA client on the sender's mail server and a MTA server on this email server present at B side. So on this host A, user agent will compose the email and forward the same to this MTA client present on this mail server. But now thing is that this sender A is not directly connected with this mail server A. So in order to forward its email from this sender A to mail server, we will be required one more mail transfer agent. Means there will be a MTA client on this machine A and MTA server on this system or server. So this user agent will prepare the email and that mail will be forwarded via MTA. Because here we need to forward the mail through LAN or WAN in order to reach this server. So for this purpose, this email will be forwarded by this MTA client to this MTA server. From this MTA server, it will be fetched by this MTA client, and this MTA client is now going to forward the same on the internet in order to reach this MTA server. From this MTA server, the mail will be forwarded to the mailbox for receiver B. As this receiver B is directly connected with this server, so it can fetch all these mails by using its user agent. So this is how email is transferred from sender to receiver when both are present at different server and sender is not directly connected with its mail server while receiver is directly connected with the mail server. In this scenario, we can see that here we have a sender and it is not directly connected with its mail server. It is connected through some LAN or WAN. Same way, receiver is also not directly connected with its mail server. It is connected through some LAN or WAN. And these mail servers are connected via internet. So in order to forward the emails from sender A to receiver B, there will be a user agent present at both the site, because user agents are responsible to compose and forward the mail at sender side, while the receiving end it is responsible for reading the emails and replying the mails. Apart from this user agent, it will be required to have MTA client at this host and MTA server so that mail composed by this user agent can be forwarded through this LAN or WAN. So this is MTA client and this is MTA server. In the same way, in order to forward this email from this mail server to another mail server, it is required to have MTA client at this server. So this is MTA client and one MTA server, TA server on receiver side. So now this email will be fetched by this MTA client and it will be forwarded via internet to this MTA receiver. You may think that why this MTA server is not directly going to forward this email to this MTA server. So always keep in your mind that in case of MTA, the direction is always from client to server. This is called push operation. So from this client to this server, there will be a push operation. But from this server to server, it cannot be forwarded. Here these are present on the same machine. So these emails will be first stored in a queue and from that queue, these emails will be fetched by this client and then this client is going to forward the same to its MTA server. After receiving the emails at this MTA server, these mails will be forwarded to the mailbox of B. As this receiver B is not directly connected with this mail server, so now this B cannot directly retrieve the emails by using its user agent. User agent can directly interact with its mail server if and only if the system is directly connected with it. And this is the reason here we are using MTA client in order to forward the same from this system to this mail server. This user agent cannot directly interact with this server because this system is not directly connected with this mail server. Same way, here also, this user agent cannot directly retrieve the emails for this host B. So here we are going to use mail access agent. So mail access agent will be present at this mail server. So mail access agent is also a client server application where the direction of message is from server to client. Means on this server there will be a mail access server and on this receiving machine there will be a mail access client. And as the direction is from server to client, means this user agent will retrieve the emails by using this mail access agent for its host B. Now you may think that why we are not using MTA here? Because this machine is acting as a client and by using MTA, client can only forward the message. It cannot receive the same from server. So here we need to have an application where the message flow should be from server to client. That is why message access agent is required to retrieve the email from this server to the receiver. Now you may think that why we cannot make this machine as a server? Why it is acting as a client only? The reason is that if you will make this machine as a server, so client will be there on the mail server. Now, this system is acting as a server, so it is necessary to be present online all the time because you cannot shut down the server. And as per the present scenario, user does not want to present online forever in order to receive the emails. So that is why we cannot make this end user as a server. So here it is a client, server will be this side. And from server to client, user agent can retrieve the emails by using mail access agent only. So what is this mail access agent? There are two protocols can be used as a message access agent. One is called POP3, Post Office Protocol, and other is called IMAP, Internet Mail Access Protocol. So IMAP version 4 is similar to POP version 3, but IMAP has more features, and also IMAP is more powerful and complex. So what are the extra features this IMAP has? First is, a user can check the email header prior to download. Means in case of if you are using IMAP protocol in order to retrieve your emails from server to receiver, you can check email header without downloading your mail. Also, by using IMAP, you can search content of email for a specific string of characters. Means in case of IMAP, it is also possible that a string of character can be searched without downloading the mail. Also, in case of IMAP, a user can create, delete, or rename the mailbox on mail server. Means these facilities are not available here in case of POP3. So we can understand overall procedure like from this sender A to this mail server, SMTP protocol is going to use. From one mail server to another mail server, SMTP will be used again. From this mail server to receiver, POP or IMAP protocol is going to use. So this is the overall process how this SMTP, POP and IMAP works together in order to forward a mail from sender to receiver. One more protocol is called MIME. It is basically used to convert a non-text data into text data or text data into non-text data. So what does it mean? Basically, by using this SMTP protocol, you can forward only text messages. In order to forward images, audio or video, it is required to convert these messages into text form. So this MIME will convert this audio, image or video in this text form at sender side. When this text will be forwarded by using this SMTP, SMTP and POP or IMAP, then at the receiving end, again, this text format will be converted into audio, video or image. So MIME stands for Multi-Purpose Internet Mail Extension. So this is how email is forwarded from one system to another system over the internet. Now let's talk about another protocol, that is SNMP protocol. SNMP is basically stands for Simple Network Management Protocol. It is basically a framework for managing devices and internet using TCP/IP protocol. Suppose you have a network. So in order to manage all these networking devices, this SNMP protocol is used. It provides set of fundamental operations for monitoring and managing an internet. So basically, this SNMP uses the concept of manager and agent. So manager is host that runs SNMP client program, while agent is some networking device like routers that runs SNMP server program. So suppose here we have SNMP client. So now this host is going to work as a manager, and these routers running SNMP server is going to act as a agent. So there are basically three components in SNMP protocol. First is called SMI, that is structure of management information. Second, MIB, and third is SNMP. So this manager and agent is going to interact through these three components only. SMI, that is structure of management information. So it is all about the structure, that is it defines the general rule for naming objects and showing how to encode objects. So basically it is all about syntax, language. In programming point of view, we can understand it like SMI is act as a language syntax, rules, how to declare an object, how to encode the objects. So all these rules are available here in this SMI. While as per the rules mentioned in this SMI, this MIB, that is management information base, is going to create a collection of named object and their relationship to each other. So from programming point of view, we can understand it as MIB is basically object declaration or definition. While SNMP defines the format of packet exchange between manager and agent. So packet format is defined by this SNMP. And programming, we can understand it as a complete program code. So here suppose we have a manager and agent. So in order to interact with this agent, what are the various processes going to happen? So let's see how this manager is going to interact with this agent by using these three components. Suppose here it's a manager's timeline and here it's agent's timeline. So first of all, this manager is going to interact with all these three components, means it is going to check what are the structure of management information, and according to that structure of management information, it is going to prepare the management information base, means it is going to create a collection of named object and their relationship with each other. And after creating these, SNMP request packet is going to be prepared. Once this packet is prepared, a SNMP request will be forwarded from this manager to agent. After receiving this request, this agent is going to reply through SNMP reply packet. So here actually what is going on? Suppose this manager is having some queries related to this agent. So how this agent is going to provide all this information? Actually, the agents keep performance information in a database, and the manager has access to the values in that database. For example, a router can store in appropriate variables the number of packets received and forwarded. Means how many packets it is receiving, how many packets it is forwarding. The manager can fetch and compare values of these two variables to see if router is congested or not. So after fetching this information, this manager can easily check that number of packets being forwarded from this site is equal to or does not equal to packets available here on this agent, means whether this router is congested or not. So this is called monitoring. In case of managing, the manager can also make router perform certain actions. For example, a router periodically checks the value of a reboot counter. Reboot counter is basically a counter. When this counter will become the zero, this router is going to reboot to update the information available in its database. Means it reboots itself when the value of the counter is zero. The manager can use these features to reboot the agent remotely at any time. So this is called managing. It simply sends a packet to force the value zero in the counter. So these are some example what kind of operation this manager is going to perform with this agent. And this is the process how this SNMP request is prepared by using these three components and how it is getting the reply. So that's all for today. Thank you.